It's time we're going to get into the Word of God and see what He has for us this morning. We're going to be in the book of Jude this morning. That's actually just, there's no chapters to Jude because it's just one letter. Just it's not real long. I've heard people say it's the shortest, but I would argue that 3 John is the shortest. But, either way, we got one chapter here that we're going to be looking at today. We're just going to kind of start at the beginning here and look at a few things that God really wants us to see this morning. And I thought it was really awesome as I was preparing this and getting this ready. I get this text message from Rudy this morning, and it was just, man, it was just right on with what God was speaking to me, and we'll get into a little bit more about that in a little bit, but about what's happening this morning. But we're going to start in verse 1. We're going to read the first 4 verses, or 3 verses, maybe 4. Depends on how we feel when we get to verse 4. But we're going to start in verse 1 because I want you to see who this is talking. Everybody, I guess it'll be on the screen if you don't have a Bible. So if you got a Bible and you love Jesus, you will open to Jude. All right. Verse 1 of Jude, it says, Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James. The interesting thing that I see with this, Jude being a brother of James, whose brother was James? Jesus' brother. Yet Jude doesn't refer to himself as Jesus' brother. You know, I have a brother, and my brother would never be my servant, as I would never be his servant. That's just not the way it works. So I don't know why Jude wouldn't have said, I'm the brother of Jesus, because man, that would give you some clout, wouldn't it? To say, I'm Jesus' brother. I was like his little brother, and I knew him. I didn't follow him, because we know none of them followed him when he was on earth, when he walked on this earth. It wasn't until he came back from the dead, they're all like, dude, we saw you die, and you're back. And he's like, I've been trying to tell you for 33 years I'm the Messiah and you won't listen. But they thought he was crazy. And then here it is, Jude, him and James ends up becoming the head elder, the pastor in the church of Jerusalem. Remember, there were 12 disciples, none of which were James or Jude. They were his brothers. They weren't followers. And then once Jesus came to them, man, they stepped in. Something happened in their life. The Holy Spirit, amen, came in and empowered them for their service. And here's Jude, the brother of Jesus, calling himself, won't even consider himself to be the brother. He says, I'm his servant, his bondservant, his slave. I'm a slave to Jesus here, is what he's telling them. And to those who have been called, who are loved in God the Father and kept for Jesus Christ, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. Verse 3, dear friends, this is the beginning of the actual letter. This is, the beginning of what he's wanting to tell. Dear friends, although I was very eager to write to you about the salvation we share, amen, about the salvation. He's wanting to talk to them. He's wanting to tell them about the salvation that they have in common. He's wanting to talk about Jesus. He's wanting to talk about the great things, the benefits that come in knowing Jesus. And yet he says, but I felt compelled to write and urge to contend. I felt compelled to write and urge you to contend for the faith that was once for all entrusted to God's holy people. That's the verse we want to look at today. He's writing this to believers, and he's telling them, I'm so excited about the salvation we share, but there's something that we need to be doing. And he says, I want to compel you. I want to urge you to begin to contend for the faith. Now, you don't want to, how do you contend? Anybody want to take a stab at that one? It's a fight. It's a fight. It's a competition. If you're contending, that makes you a what? A contender. There was this movie. You know which one I'm talking about already, huh? On the Waterfront, 1954. Marlon Brando. It's one of the most famous lines. I think it's number 34 of the top 100 famous movie quotes. That or Google lied. But he's talking to his brother. His brother was in with the mafia. Marlon Brando's character, Tommy, he's talking to his brother Charlie, Marlon Brando's character, Tommy, he was a boxer. And Charlie was in with the mob, and they convince him to throw a fight so that this mob boss can make money off of it. And he's regretted it his whole life, and at this point in the movie, he's sitting in a car talking to Charlie, and he's telling him, I could have been a contender. I could have been something, but now I'm just a bum. A little loose on the quote there, but he said, I could have really been something if I would have been fighting. I could have really been more than just a bum. I could have been more than just this wreck that I am if I would have really put all that I had into it. If you'd have let me fight, if I would have fought with everything I had, I could have been something. And today I want you to know. I want you to hear. You can be a contender. You can be something. You don't have to settle for a life of mediocrity. You don't have to settle for a life of defeat. You can get in the fight. I mean, he's not specifically, Jude isn't talking to, three people here. He's talking to believers. Those who have been called. Have you been called? No man comes to the Father. No man comes to Jesus unless he calls him. No man comes unless the Father draws him in. So I know you think, well, I found Jesus. No, Jesus found you. And then he put everything in your path to help you to find him. He called you. The reason you got out of bed and came to church this morning, the reason you kicked the devil in the teeth on the way out the door was because you were called. You were called. You were chosen by God. He said, you're called to be a contender. He said that you were called, that you were loved by God the Father. Think about that just for a minute. You were loved by God the Father. And I know we have this tendency not to put things in perspective. But think about this. Before God ever created day one, before he ever did any of that, he said, I'm going to make man. And I could just imagine Jesus sitting over there, hey, wait, what? We're going to do that? Because I get to die in that scenario. Are you sure that we're going to create men? We're going to make a planet and put a bunch of stupid people on it that I get to go and die for? No, that wasn't the way the conversation went. See, God said, I'm going to make these people, and they're going to do me so wrong, but I love them. And I'm going to bring them into existence, and I'm going to die for them because of what they're going to do. I'm going to do it. Before he ever spoke anything into existence, he knew what would take place. And yet he loved us so much that he did it anyway. Jesus knew from the very beginning, day one, let there be light. God spoke everything to him. Before any of that ever happened, Jesus said, I can't wait to die for them. I can't wait to lay down my life so that they can know me. Because while we were just a hot mess, while we were sinners, said Jesus died for us. The Bible calls him the Lamb of God that was crucified from the foundation of the world. So when the world was made, he already knew. And he loved us in spite of us. Because I'm going to tell you, it's hard to love people. Come on, somebody. Let's just be brutally honest up in here. I mean, you walked in the door with three or four people that you're probably like, I want to punch you in the mouth rather than shake your hand. I mean, we've had so many things happen in our church. It's so funny because restraining orders, arguments, fights, and we've had the police show up here before Sunday morning service started because we're people. I remember I was on my way to the stage, and they come in. I think it was Mike came up and told me, the cops are here. They're asking for you. Because we're a bunch of knuckleheads. And I'm like, oh, we're starting. But, you know, that's just, you know, that's who we are, man. We're people. We're gonna do stupid things. We're going to make mistakes, but God loves us anyway. He loved us so much that he made a way. John 3:16, you know it. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believed in him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. He loved us that much. And we struggle just to like people. And you get on your own nerves. I like that. But we're people. I mean, we have a hard time liking ourselves. How can God, the Father, love us so much? But he did. You were called. You're loved. And I like the next one. You're kept in Jesus. Or that word there right before Jesus. That if you look at it in your Bible, you'll see a little annotation next to it. And it says kept by Jesus, kept for Jesus, kept in Jesus. I mean, the words are interchangeable there. You're kept by Jesus. You're kept for Jesus. You're kept in Jesus. Any way you look at it, I love it. I'm kept for Jesus is what the NIV says. That I'm the bride that is to be without spot or wrinkle. That I'm the one that's to be without blemish one day. That we, as the church, are the bride of Christ. And the Holy Spirit's working some overtime up in this place to make sure we're what we're supposed to be when Jesus is ready for his bride. Now, to be kept for Jesus, I can't help but think of the image of marriage, that a woman, a girl would keep herself pure for her husband, or a husband would keep himself pure for his bride until the wedding day. That they wouldn't give themselves to anybody else, that they would keep themselves pure, even for a husband they don't know yet. For a mate, someone that's coming, that they keep themselves. But here's the thing, as this body, as this bride, I was flawed to begin with. I wasn't pure in the beginning, but because of what he did, he made me pure. So no matter what the mistakes I've made, at this point, once the cross came into the picture in my life and I gave my life to Jesus, everything changed. Said, you're a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. And now you're being kept for him. But our problem is we let so many other things come in. And instead of being kept pure for our husband, instead of being kept pure for Jesus, we find ourselves giving ourselves to so many things. Why is that? Because we're not fighting. We're not contending for the faith. We're not contending, fighting for what we know to be true. We're not fighting this fight. We almost, it's like, do you know you have an enemy? There is a very real devil out there. A very real devil. And we act like there's nothing going on. We're not going to fight. It's just, man, I came to Jesus and I came to church and he's like supposed to buy me a car. You know, it's like Obama. I voted for him. He's supposed to give me a phone and pay my rent. It didn't happen. 8 years later, we're still waiting for the phone. Still waiting for my rent to be paid. He ain't done nothing for me but take my insurance away. But our hope ain't in man. It's in Jesus. It's in the one who loved us enough to die for us. That's where our hope is. That's where our love is. It's not in what God can do for me. It's in I get Jesus, and nothing else matters. He's all that I need. And that really, really ticks off the devil. And he wants to mess me up for that. And I'm in the middle of a struggle. I'm in the middle of a fight. Look in the Old Testament at the kings. God told the kings, do not take foreign wives. Now, was he just being racist? No. Has nothing to do with a race. Had everything to do with being equally yoked. And I know we look at equally yoked and we think, well, that's for marriage. And you know what? It wasn't even talking about marriage when he said it. He's just talking about the people you hang out with. Who's in your circle of friends? Who's in the people that you deal with every day? Who is it that you hang out with? That's the yoking. But these kings in the Old Testament, he told them, don't take foreign wives. What's the first thing these knuckleheads do? Yeah, you didn't mean that. I'll take some, you know, it's for a good cause. I mean, look at Solomon. He had what you call treaty wives. Because it was part of a treaty that they were signing. It's like, I'm the more dominant force, and I agree that I won't kill you. We'll make this agreement, and you'll give me your daughter as my wife, so we're like family. Because everybody knows family wouldn't hurt anybody. You know how many kings were killed by their kids? A brother, an uncle, it's always somebody close. And we think that worked. So they take these wives to try and form an alliance. But it was for a good cause. It was for peace. I did it for peace, God. I know I got like 1,000 wives, but I just needed one more for the sake of peace. Good cause, right? Peace. God loves peace. Shalom and everything. But what happened? The people he should have been killing, he's starting to make treaties with. The people he should have been at war with, he's starting to befriend them, bring them into the family. And what happens? It says those wives that he brought in that didn't love his God, that had their own God, when they came in, they, you know, hey, there's nothing. Yeah, some people may have experienced a nagging wife. I'm blessed not to have a nagging wife. Don't you dare say that I said my wife was a nagging wife. My wife is an awesome wife. But some of you may understand, you know, it's like a nagging wife, it says in the Bible, is like a drip. And the longer it drips, the more you want to do something about it. And these wives, these foreign wives are complaining to Solomon, you get to go to church and we don't get to go to church. Well, just come with me and say, I don't go to your church. I want my own church. So what does he do? He builds them temples to their God. This is the guy who's known as the wisest man ever. I don't know. People tend to remember you for your mistakes more than your successes, right? How come we're still calling him wise? I guess it's because God did. But his heart was pulled away. Why? Because he stopped fighting. We were called to be contenders. We were called to be fighters. It's 1 Timothy 6:12. It'll be on the screen if you can't find it. But it says, fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Fight the good fight of faith. It's a fight. It's a fight. Contend for the faith. Fight for your faith. Realize that you got a real enemy out there that wants to destroy you, that wants to kill you. 1 Peter 5:8-9. I'm going to Show you who your enemy is right here. It says, be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy. Wait. I thought we didn't have enemies. I thought we were at peace, that everything was going to be great whenever we gave our life to Jesus. No, when you gave your life to Jesus, you changed sides is all you did. You stopped being a pawn of the devil, and now you became a servant of the Most High God. And so the other side don't like the fact that you changed sides, and he wants to hurt you now. So your enemy, the devil. I don't believe in the devil. Too bad. God does. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. He wants to devour you. He's prowling around like a roaring lion. And he wants to eat you. But what does he say to do? Verse 9. Resist him. Stand firm in the faith. Now, to stand firm is to mean I'm not going to lose ground. I'm not going to give in to anything that the enemy is bringing against me. I'm digging in my heels. And I'm not going to let him advance. I'm going to stand in opposition to him. There's a war that's going on. There is a war that's being waged. And you can decide to get in, or you can keep sitting on the sidelines and think that, I don't see it. You can keep saying, I won't bother you, you don't bother me, but guess what he does? He keeps bothering you. Anybody remember World War II? Hitler. France was really worried that he was fixing to come in and take over France. And so what did they do? They went and signed a peace treaty with him. Hey, devil, you don't bother us, we won't bother you. You stay on your side, we'll stay on our side. And they're like, what's the devil going to do? He's going to lie to you. And he's going, oh, yeah, that's cool. We won't bother France at all. And guess what happened on their way home? They were right behind them. As the diplomats from France are pulling through the arches there. They're like, we're home, yeah. They turn around and look, and there's Hitler pulling his tanks in with them. Because that devil, he ain't making treaties. And in your life, he wants to destroy you. He wants to eat you. He wants to devour you. It says he goes around like a roaring lion. He makes a lot of noise. But you know, he's powerless against you. He's powerless to defeat you because greater is he who is in you than he who's in the world. But the minute you stop fighting, the minute you stop contending, he's right there. All of a sudden, that dog that was all bark, he's starting to chew a little bit. He's starting to dig his teeth in a little bit. Where he was just roaring and making a lot of noise before, now we're giving him ground because we stop fighting. We need to realize that devil, man, we need to take the fight to him. We need to, there's this guy, this verse that Rudy sent me this morning. 2 Samuel 23 and 20, and I'm going to put it in the New Living Translation. He sent it in King James because he was confused. But the New Living Translation, I want you to see this. It says, there was also Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, a valiant warrior from Kabzeel. I don't know why you'd even claim that town. It's a terrible name. He did many heroic deeds, which included killing two champions of Moab. Another time, on a snowy day, he chased a lion down into a pit and killed it. He saw a lion and he thought, you know what? Instead of him coming after me, I'm going after him. Instead of letting that lion come and scare me, I'm going to show that lion who's boss. Now, this wasn't just a cub lion, okay? I don't want you to think, oh, he chased down a kitty cat. How mean. He killed a kitten in a hole. No. He was hunting the lion, not the lion hunting him. And though that enemy is prowling around looking for who he can devour, when you get up in the morning and you start setting your sights on him, guess where he's going to go? He's going to run. He's going to go the other way. See, you got a choice. You can be one of those people that whenever you get up in the morning, the devil's hunting you. Or you can be one of those people that when you get up in the morning, the devil's like, oh, shoot. He's up. Are you going to contend? Are you going to fight for the faith? Are you going to stay in the fight? But I don't want you to think that the devil is the only enemy you got. Sometimes we're giving way too much credit to the devil. One time, I remember there's this time. I was at church camp when I was in probably junior high, early high school, something like that. And I went to church camp, and the director of this camp had this brilliant idea. It was the first and only time we ever did this. We took all, like, you know, I think there was 500 people at this camp, and we loaded up in buses, and we're in Mountain Air, New Mexico. So we're in kind of no trees, you know, just in mountain area. It's kind of rolling hills, you know, some, you know, it's not a great, like, you think, you know, northern New Mexico, trees and mountains, but it was a lot like here, only hilly, you know, rocks and, you know, mesquite bushes. And they load us up in buses in the middle of the night, and they take us to a field that someone owned nearby. And they had flashlights, you know, the leaders had flashlights. And what the thing was, we would all go to this field, and we all sat out in a field. They'd already arranged, you know, logs and rocks and everything for people to sit around in big circle. And they would have testimonies. And it was such a beautiful night. It was so black. All the stars were out. There was no moon, so you didn't have much light when they turned off the flashlight. You could just see the beautiful stars. I mean, it was amazing. And everybody's gathered around, and people would take turns. They would come forward, and they'd have a flashlight, and they were in the middle of the circle. And they basically, it's funny, because if I hold a flashlight, I'm shining on all of you. And they're holding it like, you know, that eerie, scary look. You know, the flashlight under their face, and all you see is the shadows and of their face. And they're holding this flashlight, and they're giving testimonies. And there were some great testimonies. Well, while this is happening, I was at the far end of the circle, me and some other kids that were there. And as the people are talking, there's cows in this field. Lots of cows in this field. And we're on a cow path. You know, we're blocking him from getting somewhere. And these cows are coming up, and as they're walking up, they're not making a sound. I mean, you could barely hear them coming up. And I'm turning around, and I'm looking. I'm like, oh, look at all these cows. You know, a bunch of cows coming up. Well, there's this guy named Jamie Throckmorton from Roswell. And he was terrified of cows, evidently. And he's sitting over at the side over here, and he's looking back at those cows. He's like, oh, man, those cows are coming. They're coming. They're standing there. If you go into a field with a bunch of cows, they're like, what are white people doing in a bunch of this field? It doesn't make any. Why are people here? They're not supposed to be here. And we're still looking at the cows. Cows are looking at us. And this lady, this young girl's over here giving a testimony. And in this testimony, she's just talking about her trials and tribulations. You know, the devil tried to kill me when I was a baby. The devil's been after me my whole life. The devil, the devil, the devil. He's coming at me. Well, in the middle of this conversation, this girl's having this testimony of how awesome the devil is, evidently. She's talking about how the devil's always trying to kill her, always after her. Jamie decides, I'm going to get rid of these cows. It's dark. I mean, there's no light other than this girl's face that's glowing eerily as she speaks of the devil. Jamie picks up a rock and he throws it and he hits one of the cows. Well, what's a cow going to do when you hit it with a rock? It's going to make a wailing noise, man. And it, you hear this cow, and then, so what do all the other cows do? They're like, Whoa, they're making all this racket. Have you ever heard the term, the phrase, thundering herd? As this stampede began to go the other way. It was, whoa, man, you hear these, man, you could really hear them at that point. They're yelling and making a noise, all these cattle, and they're running the other way. And man, it freaked me out. I jump up and I'm like, what? I'm ready to go. You know, I'm like, oh, good, they're going the other way. And Jamie's really feeling a sense of accomplishment. Like, whoo, got rid of those cows. And we turn around. And those couple hundred people that are around that circle there in the testimony time, as this girl's talking about how the devil's trying to kill her whenever those cows made that eruptive noise. Somebody screams, it's the devil! And one stampede went that way, and one stampede went that way. And I turned, it was the funniest thing. Because you see flashlights coming on, and it is like, what? And all the dirt in the air, it looked like lightsabers. You know, we got a light show going out here in this desert. You know, and they people are running for their life, man. And as people are running, well, guess what's right there? A fence. Barbed wire fence, no joke. People are running at full sprint, and they're hit. They don't know where they're going. They have no clue, and they hit this fence. Boom, they go flat. They just flop over the fence, and as people are going down, I mean, it was like bodies everywhere. People are all running the same direction. And I remember seeing this little girl that was in our group, in our youth group, as she hurdled everybody to get over that fence. She ends up landing on the other side, twists her knee. I mean, it was just crazy. My sisters, they were all wounded. I mean, it was awesome. It was incredible. Best camp ever. Everybody's screaming about how the devil is attacking, you know. Where are the great people of faith, man? When the devil shows up, but guess what? It wasn't the devil. It was Jamie Throckmorton. Because he decided to throw a rock at a bunch of cows. What do you think they're going to do? They weren't bothering. They were just listening to testimonies, man. And we ran them off. Then when I remember they came. I was talking to one of the guys, the leaders of the thing, and they're like, what happened? Oh, my goodness. We're loading. The ambulances are coming. I mean, it was crazy. We got stretchers out there. We're loading people up and taping sticks to their legs. I mean, it was insane. Insane. We had to wait for the wounded to go first. It was so hilarious. But we're out there for hours just waiting to get back, and what was this great plan just to turn into a disaster. Not because of the devil, but because of Jamie Throckmorton. But the devil was getting a lot of credit that night. A lot of credit. And as we get back to the thing, and everybody, you know, of course, it's youth camp, and you got all these wounded people. So the ones who weren't wounded, we're like prayer warriors, man. We're going in, we're praying for people. And people are like, I think a cow ran over me. I was like, that's rude to call people that. I was like, it wasn't really a cow. No, it was a cow. I saw it. No, it was just a very large person. Not a cow. The devil really had his hand in this night. No, he didn't. It was all because somebody was stupid. And too many times, we're blaming the devil because we're hanging out in the dark being stupid. What are we doing? Because we stopped fighting the enemy, and now we're hanging out with the enemy. We're not being kept clean. We're not being kept pure. We're asking ourselves, and I know you thought it, because I thought it too. How much can I get away with and still get in? You know, how much sin can I enjoy and still be able to get into heaven? We're not fighting sin. We're not fighting the enemy. We're trying to play with it. We're hanging out where we shouldn't be in the dark. And what did you say? What fellowship does light have with darkness? Stop hanging out in those places and start battling those places. Start fighting that addiction. Stop playing with it. Tear down alcoholism in your family. Don't entertain it. Well, it's just social drinking. Social drinking that turned into an addiction that I can't shake. It's just this, or it's just, and we start making exceptions. We start making excuses. Well, I can't give this up. Well, go ahead and play in the dark. But if you're not fighting, what are you doing? And one day you're going to be sitting there in the back seat of the car with Charlie. And you're going to say, I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody. I could have been great in the kingdom of God. You know, I had a professor in Bible college. This man, the things that he has done, the things that he has seen, I mean, it just blows my mind how God has used him in so many ways, in such magnificent ways. He's preached all around the world. And yet, one day he was just being so vulnerable, so raw and open with us. And he says, my biggest fear, because we're all wondering, how on earth do you get so much done? I mean, this man is a machine of ministry. How do you do it? What motivates you? You know what he said? My biggest fear is that I'm going to get to heaven and God's going to give me my portion. I'm going to be, yeah, I'll be satisfied with what God gives me. But my biggest fear is that he's going to say, this is what you get. But this is what you could have got. Yeah, you made it. You did real good, kind of, for a while. But this is what you could have had. We act like there's no reward. We act like it's just about just getting in the door. But if your mentality is just to get in the door, you're probably not going to. It's about fighting the good fight, contending for the faith, taking the fight to that lion and letting him know who's boss. It's about stop blaming others. Stop blaming people. Stop blaming your parents. Stop blaming the devil for choices that you're making. I'll give you that the first time. What were you doing hanging out in a crack house? Well, my mom. She was very mean to me. She even called me idiot and stupid. And so did my mom. She beat me with rods, and then they would hang me up by my toenails. And man, you probably got a horrible story about your mom. I get it. But your mom didn't drive you to the crack house. It's your fight for you to fight. Nobody else can fight your fight. I can't contend for you. I can pray for you. But it's your fight to get in. And if you're here today, I want to tell you, it's time to take the fight to the enemy. Amen. But you can't fight the enemy if you're hanging out with him. Wasn't that Samson's whole problem? He couldn't judge the Philistines because he liked them too much. So God had to get him invested. God had to get him to the point where he was really wanting to wipe them out. So they took his strength, they took his eyes, and he got in a place finally where God could use him. And it says more Philistines died that day because he gave everything. He gave all that he had for the fight. And I promise you, whenever that day was over, it wasn't just that, well, we got, you know, Samson buried in a bunch of rubble. As that rubble fell and he gave his life, I can just imagine those angels that are standing there next to him. Dude, that was awesome. We didn't know if you was going to do it, but you did it. And Samson stepped off into eternity on the right side because he got back in the fight. Get back in the fight. Contend for the faith. Don't give up. Don't cut yourself short. Get in there. Do it. Amen. You know, James tells us, when tempted, James 1, 13 and 14, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each person is tempted when they are dragged away by that mean old devil. No. Is that on the screen? Can y'all read that? When they are dragged away by their own evil desire and enticed. So today we've really been talking about two enemies here. The devil, who is that roaring lion that you need to go out and put him in a hole somewhere and kill him. Okay, that's enemy number one. But enemy number two is you. And the only reason I made you number two instead of number one, because it rhymes with two. So the enemy in all of this is the devil and us, our fleshly desire. But when we get in the fight and we start fighting that devil, we start contending for the faith, you don't have to worry about it anymore. You're on the right side. You're on the winning side. Amen? But just like in that story I told, too many times we're hanging out places we shouldn't be, doing things we shouldn't be doing, and we know it. That voice that you have inside your head that's screaming at you, don't go there, don't do this, turn around, go the other way. That's the Holy Spirit talking to you. And you can win this fight. You can win this fight. I don't care what's been coming against you, what lion you're chasing, what lion is coming against you seeking to devour you, whether it be addiction, whether it be finances, whatever that lion, you know what that lion is, I hope. I hope you know what that thing is that you're needing to destroy, that's been chasing you down. What is it? It may be one thing today, it may be something else tomorrow. But your tomorrow is never going to come if you don't fight the one you got to fight today. So what is he calling you to fight today? What is he calling you to kill? What is he calling you to contend against in your faith? What darkness is creeping into your life? Today can be the day. Today is the day where you can go to war against that thing, where you can battle that thing, where you can kill that lion in your life. Where do you stand? What's happening in your life? Have you been giving way too much ground to the enemy? Have you been giving way too much ground to your own personal desires? Get back in the fight. Amen. Can we pray together? Lord, you see us. You know our hearts, you know our lives, the situation that we're in. And God, we need victory today. God, we need to get into this fight. Instead of letting that lion chase us down, we need to turn around and chase him down. We need to take the fight to him. We need to overcome whatever that is, that lion that's trying to destroy our lives. And God, today I pray for victory in this place. I pray that you will be victorious in our lives, that we can do what we need to do by the power of the Holy Spirit that you've already promised us, that's already available to us. God, I just pray for conviction. For those of us that keep hanging out in dark places. For those of us that keep dabbling with darkness. That we would see it as our enemy instead of our friend. that we would go to war with it instead of playing with it. God, I pray for your victory in this place today. That hearts and lives will be changed in this place today. I don't know what you're fighting, but you do. I don't know what's coming against you. I don't know what you've been struggling with. But today, victory can be yours. You can be an overcomer because of what Jesus has already done. He's empowering you for the fight. Man, you want to see God move in your life. You want to see miracles. You want to see God using you. You want to see all the miracles that they saw in Acts. Then it's time to get in the fight. It's time to go to war against that lion. It's time to take the fight to him, to tell that devil, I'm not giving you anymore. I'm going to dig in my heels. I'm going to stand firm in my faith. I'm going to fight. Instead of letting that devil rob you of your family, fight him. Instead of letting that devil take your children, fight him. Instead of letting him have your country, fight him. Fight him today. Get a hold of God today. Don't let that devil win. I know he's making a bunch of noise. I know he's a scary lion. But all he can do is make a bunch of noise. Unless you let him do more. When the Bible says don't give a foothold to the enemy, that's what he's talking about. Don't give him a place to attack. Don't give him a place that he could come in. Stop hanging out in the places you've been hanging out. Stop doing the wrong things that you know God's been telling you to stop. Fight that lion. Tell him no more. You can't have my life. You can't have my family. I'm not giving in to you. I'm fighting you. So is there anybody here ready to fight this devil today? Is there anybody here ready to overcome that flesh today? Are you ready to become a contender so you don't have to be a bum? Are you ready to go all in for the kingdom of God, to fight that enemy, to tear him apart? Then today is your day. Would you stand with me? Today can be a pivotal moment for you. Today can be the day where you either walk out of here with regret or you walk out of here in victory. You can walk out of here defeated or you can walk out here in the fight. It's your choice. What are you going to do? What are you going to lay down? What are you going to go to war against today? There's people all over this place today that you know God is speaking something to you today. Lay that down. Get rid of that thing that's in your life. Get rid of that. Fight that thing. Stop the surrender today. So if you need to get in the fight, if you need to give yourself back to the one who made all of this possible, the only one who can bring victory in your life, if you want to give yourself back to Jesus, if you want to give that thing that you've been playing with, that darkness that you've been entertaining, if you want to give that to God today, you may say, well, it ain't even a sin. The Bible didn't even talk about it. But did God talk to you about it? And if God told you to stop, why didn't you? Because if God told you to stop and you keep going, hate to say it, but it makes it sin. What darkness are you playing with? What darkness are you ready to lay down? What lion do you need to grab by the teeth and just rip him to pieces? Because today's your day. And if there's something that needs to come out of your life, if there's an enemy you need to go to war with today, I'm going to invite you to come down to the front. You can find a place to pray, or we'll pray with you. But today is a day of victory. Amen. So while the worship team plays, I want to invite you to come. Don't rush out the door. God may speak something to you. You may have a word from Him today. And if you run out too soon, all you get is regret. Get a hold of God today. I invite you to come.